In this video, we're going to look at pipe flow with minor losses. So we've seen this a number of times in previous videos. If we write our Bernoulli equation from station 1 to station 2, adding the loss term that we have due to both major losses, or the friction in the pipe, and the minor losses due to the fittings, we find that we've seen already that we can calculate the major losses using the friction factor with an expression where HL due to the major losses, the component of HL due to the major losses, is given by this expression. And the only thing that's being added here now is that we're adding HL minor, being an expression to be a loss coefficient times V squared over 2G. Basically, what we're doing here is looking at what is this loss coefficient. So those minor losses are coming about due to all of the other things that are on our piping systems. And we saw in the opening video, piping systems that are all kinds of examples of different fittings. You have pipes changing diameters from one size to another. You have elbows in those pipes. You have T's or branches in the pipes. You have diffusers where the air is being distributed into a room from a duct. You have changes of sizes between pipe 1 and pipe 2. If you're going to a smaller pipe, that might be a contraction. To a larger pipe, that might be expansion. There's many different kinds of valves that we could find in our piping systems. There might be flow meters or other instrumentation that happens to be there. Basically, anything that we're putting into our piping system that deviates from the straight flow in a pipe where we have friction losses is going to give us minor losses in our system. So it could be anything else. In addition, we might have entrance or exit effects. An entrance effect, if we stick a pipe into a reservoir and we have stagnant flow in the reservoir coming into the pipe, how we bring that flow into the pipe is going to change the losses that we have adjusting to that piping system. And we may well have exit losses to a reservoir, but we're going to have to be careful and look at our implementation of the Bernoulli equation as to when we have this term or not. And you can see right away from the expression of the minor losses, it's a loss coefficient times a V squared over 2G. Well, if we have a V squared going out of a pipe and we're not explicitly accounting for that one half or that V squared over 2G term in our Bernoulli equation, we can account for it by simply adding a loss coefficient of 1, and that will give us the effect due to the kinetic energy of the flow leaving that pipe at that point. We'll look at some specific examples and see whether this makes sense or not, but sometimes you will see that exit factor being 1, and you don't double count. If you count that in your Bernoulli equation with a V squared, with a kinetic energy term, you won't put it in as a loss factor. Okay, so let's look at an example of what this loss coefficient might be. An elbow is an example. An elbow is a device where we're turning a corner in our flow. And we could have an elbow like this, where we have a very tight corner, or maybe we have a much more gradual elbow with a much longer radius. So we might see something called a short radius elbow or a long radius elbow. But in either case, what we have is a fluid that is moving along, perhaps a straight pipe section, and it hits this elbow. And then it's going to leave eventually as a nice developed flow again going in that direction. But when we hit this corner, we may well have some interesting things happening in the fluid mechanics. We may well have a separation at this edge where you get a recirculating flow where the flow can't turn that corner sharply enough, and so you get this flow separation. The core of the flow comes out closer to this back wall before adjusting again and coming in and coming back to the center. And if we were to look at a cross section of our pipe in that direction, we'll see our circular cross section. And you can imagine that if the bulk of the flow in the center of the pipe is moving out to a higher radius before it comes back in conjunction with a separation such as this, you may well see a secondary flow pattern where, of course, there has to be flow in the channel moving it out to that outer radius. And if that's the case, it's going to swirl around and you'll get these two counter-rotating vortices in the pipe flow, which eventually will dissipate and will come back to a fully developed flow. But all of these adjustments from a potential separation here to these secondary flows that are induced as the maximum velocity shifts to a higher radius and then adjusts again are going to result in extra losses in the flow, and therefore we can account for that using this loss coefficient K. In addition, you can well imagine that the fluid mechanics in a long radius elbow are going to be different than the fluid mechanics in a short radius elbow. You may well have a separation here and an extreme departure from the maximum being at the center of the pipe that you don't have here. It may be much more subtle here. So you would expect that a loss factor for the short radius will be greater than the loss factor for the long radius. And of course, it's a trade-off when you make a piping system, because this long radius pipe is going to mean that the pipe takes up more space, or it's further away from the ceiling or the walls, and you can of course turn tighter corners and get your piping system more out of the way when you use the short radius pipes, short radius elbows, but you're going to end up with larger losses, or you're going to need to compensate for larger pressure drops using those short ones. In addition, these things may be connected different ways. You see in that example of the pipe, in that pipe video at the very beginning, there were some fittings that were used pipe clamps or were essentially flanged. And if they were flanged, what that means is you have a section off here, and then the next section of pipe comes across here. And so this is our pipe carrying on, and perhaps we have a bolt through here to connect these, or in those examples, there was a pipe clamp holding those together. And this junction here, which probably has a little gasket in it, may result in some of these losses as well. Whereas perhaps we have a nice soldered pipe where the two ends are coming nicely together, and there are welded pipe where it's butt welded, where you have an edge coming together on a face and then a weld bead around the outside. That's going to result in different details of the flow here and potentially slightly different losses yet again. So when you look it up from a reputable source to find out what the loss coefficient for the particular elbows in your system are, you're going to have to know whether it's a short radius or a long radius, whether it's a flanged or a soldered, or what that fitting type is, or you're going to have to make the best available guess from the information you have that's closest to the system that you in fact are using. And of course there are elbows that are 45 degrees instead of 90 degrees, and maybe even some other angles as well. So the onus is on you to make sure you're getting your data from a reputable source and getting data that is representative of the fittings that you have in your pipe, and then you will be able to carry out calculations to good engineering accuracy. A valve is another example of an element that we see in there, and let's look just as an example again. Let's take a gate valve. So at gate valve, we have the flow coming in from a pipe. You might have a bit of a bulge on the bottom. And so we have, again, some connection to the pipe. It may be flanged, it may be screwed, it may be welded. And we have some handle up here that's controlling some device. In this case, let's say it's a gate valve. And so we have this gate in here that can be moved up or down. And this is an interesting one because, of course, the flow is going to come in. It's going to have to move around this and carry on. And depending on the level of this gate being fully open or almost closed, you're going to have a different loss factor in there again. And so in this kind of valve in particular, KL fully open should be less than KL part open. And different types of valves will have different types of structures in there. You have diaphragm valves, you have ball valves, and each of those have a different mechanism and a different flow path through here. And different manufacturers' valves may have longer lengths on either side here, and different internal flow paths. And so again, the onus is on you to find the correct KL value, or as close a correct KL value as you can find, for the actual valves that you're going to use in your piping system. Expansions and contractions are potentially a little bit of an interesting one. If we look at a typical contraction, let's say we have a sharp contraction here. So we're going from an area 1 to an area 2, and the flow is in this direction. Now, remember that our loss coefficient, or our head loss due to minor losses, is equal to our loss coefficient times a V squared over 2G. Well, obviously in this system, I have one velocity here on the A1 side, where I have a larger pipe, which is going to be a larger velocity on the A2 side here. And so very often the question comes up, what is the velocity that I use with this? And well, the answer to that is going to be, it depends where you get your information. What you'll typically find for a system such as this is that you'll find the data might be given to you in terms of a graph where we plot KL versus and the area ratio, A2 over A1. And that might have some curve that looks like this. As you go to larger and larger area ratios, if this area is much bigger than this area, we have a larger loss than if we go down to a value of 1, when this loss coefficient should, of course, reach 0 when there is no contraction whatsoever. But when you pick up information like this, it should be defined which value of velocity is using to correspond to the data that is given to you. So if in this case, I would not be able to complete this graph. Of course, I would make this graph by taking measurements of the pressure drop through these fittings. And as a manufacturer of these fittings, I would provide this information, or perhaps it's in standard tables for sharp contractions like this. But you must find the data and understand how it is represented. So it will not be complete until it tells you that for this data, that is based on the velocity 2, for example, and it could be 2 squared over 2g. And that's telling you that when they fitted this data, when they came up with this data, they were normalizing the pressure drops with the velocity in the outlet section of the pipe. And it could arbitrarily have been done the other way. Be very careful to make sure that you are using the correct velocity in your expressions as the data was prepared that you're using. So don't be confused about which velocity to use. It is important that you use the right velocity for the particular data that you found. And that you'd have a similar graph for an expansion. The loss coefficients would, of course, be different if you had an expansion, but it would be a similar presentation of the data, and you would find the right data for your system. Okay, very often we have entrance effects in pipes, and if you imagine that we have some kind of reservoir, and we put a pipe in it, we can do that in different ways. Here's some ways that we can do that. We could have... There's four different ways that we can do that. This one here we might call a reentrant entrance. And in a reentrant entrance, we might have an interesting flow because this is into our pipe. We're going to have flow coming eventually from all parts of our reservoir, and we might have this sharp entrance. So we might have these recirculations, and the flow would come around and eventually adjust and eventually get our fully developed flow profile some distance downstream. And so this disturbance around here is something that we're going to account for with this loss coefficient. And in this case, we might say the loss coefficient is something on the order of, say, a 0.8, and call that a reentrant entrance. We could look at a condition where we had instead a sharp-edged entrance, and that is going to give us a little bit lower losses, as it turns out. Here you might see a KL of something on the order of 0.5 for a sharp edge. And so there's that sharp edge. And of course, the physics of the flow around this corner is different than this one. And it turns out when you do experiments on this that you have a lower loss here than when you actually stick the pipe well inside the reservoir. If you want to reduce the losses even more, you can start to round these corners. And if you round these corners, you may well find that you get a loss coefficient of, say, KL is equal to 2. KL is equal to something on the order of 0.2. And that's when we have a slightly rounded entrance. And here we have extremely rounded entrance. And we can, if we do that very well, if we do go to the effort of contouring that correctly and making that as nice as we can, we can almost get rid of these losses. You can certainly drop it by almost an order of magnitude, or ballpark an order of magnitude, for very well-rounded entrance. And of course, again, the trade-off is you may well find that this is by far the easiest thing to manufacture. You drill a hole in the side of this, you stick the pipe through and make sure that there's not going to be any leaks through there because the pipe's sticking through nicely, and then you can put a weld bead around there and seal it off. That's perhaps a little bit harder when that edge is right there. You're probably not going to get it perfectly aligned. It's going to be a more difficult weld. And so if you're not careful, you're going to end up with a reentrant. But your losses are going to be perhaps somewhere in between those kinds of values. Obviously, you're manufacturing something a little bit more complicated at this point. You probably would have been manufactured a piece that came out with this rounding, and then you'd connect your pipe out there. So that's a more complicated operation to do, but you get the benefit of slightly lower losses through there. And again, this one is going to both take up more space, and it's going to be much more work in order to make it, but you've almost eliminated the losses due to that. So again, with entrances, you look for the words in the problem description that give you a clue as to what type of entrance it is, and you're going to pick a value that's somewhere in this range from around 0.8 to almost neglecting the entrance effect entirely. Okay, so now that we know that we can go to our reputable sources and get loss coefficients for all the different kinds of fittings that we would have on a piping system, or perhaps in a question in this course, those coefficients might be given to you, or the data from which you could calculate them or determine them for your particular expansions and contractions, etc., may well be given to you. And then where do we go with that? Well, if we have a single pipe diameter with fittings, so we have a certain length of this pipe, and we have all kinds of minor losses on there, then we can expand our equation from the beginning slide. Of course, we have, in this case, our Bernoulli equation written in terms of units of meters or head. So we have the pressure head, the kinetic energy head, and the gravitational potential head. Same thing on the two side. And if we've had major losses, we will have a term here, which is FL over D times the velocity squared over 2G. And however many fittings we had in that single pipe diameter, we would add up all of those loss coefficients and multiply it by V1 squared over 2G. Of course, when it's a single pipe diameter, it's in all likelihood we're going to cancel out these terms, so we can get rid of those. And we don't need to talk about V1s or V2s because the velocity is all the same. It's a single diameter with no area changes. And therefore, we can talk about how we can reduce this equation to this expression here. And you can see that this looks quite similar to the examples we did when there were only major losses, except we have this extra term here. So we know that if we have flow rate unknown problems, we're going to have to do some iterating, and we can follow exactly the same technique that we used when we didn't have minor losses, except that our equation for the velocity, if we rearrange this and solve for the velocity, we see that whereas before we had only the FL over D term, now we have an FL over D plus the sum of all of those minor losses. And of course, that should have my subscript L on it for the loss coefficients, minor loss coefficients. And that's the expression we would use to now add those pipe fittings and carry on with similar examples, which we'll do in a subsequent video. When we have multiple type pipe diameters, so that is, imagine we had a system where we had pipe 1, and we had a contraction going down to pipe 2, and then let's say we had an expansion to an even bigger pipe 3, and so we had diameter 1, diameter 2, and diameter 3, and we could add any number of diameters to this, and of course we could have a bunch of elbows in this section. I haven't drawn any fittings other than the contraction and the expansion here, but we could have all kinds of valves or fittings, different things in each one of these diameters. But we can group all of these things together. So exactly as before, in this case, I'm going to call this an intermediate value. Let's call this DI for an intermediate value. Then I'm going to call this one 2. My apologies for that, just to make it match the equation here. Call that one D2. So I'm writing my Bernoulli equation. I have my pressure at 1, my pressure at 2, my velocity at 1, my velocity at 2, the gravitational potential at each of those locations. And then all of the lengths of the pipes here I can add together and get the total length of the pipe at diameter 1 times the friction factor that I determine in pipe 1 as a to calculate the Reynolds number of the flow rate in this particular pipe. And all any fittings that I have in here would be summed up into this K here, multiplying the velocity that we find in pipe 1. And then I would add the exact same terms for, now it should be written I as I have here, but whatever's happening in this pipe, I have a different velocity again, the velocity in this pipe, and it has a certain length of total length of pipe, and it has its number of fittings, which could be any number of fittings, where you can add up its coefficients. And likewise, I can go into the now what I've called two, the next size diameter, and add up all the lengths for that pipe and all the fittings in that pipe. And you see, we can just keep adding these terms, these two terms, one for the major losses, one for the minor losses, for any number of diameter changes. And as a matter of fact, if we went back to a diameter one here, we could simply add that length that we have in a diameter one here into this term, because we just need to group it all into the things which are multiplying the velocity in the one pipe and the two pipe. And of course, if the diameter is the same, the velocities are going to be the same if we have the entire flow going through our system and there's no branches in the systems or no pipe branches. So we can express now, using conservation of mass for an incompressible fluid, that V1A1 is equal to V2A2 is equal to V3A3. And therefore, we can express our V2 and our V3 as a function of the diameters of our pipes, which we would know in our piping system, or which we would in all likelihood know unless we were doing a diameter unknown problem. And that means that I can substitute in, and I have made an assumption here, by the way, of a circular pipe. So I had the diameter was pi d squared over 4, and of course the pi's and the 4's cancelled from pipes 1 and 2. So for a circular section, I get this relation of the square of the velocities is what is that ratio is what gives me V2 from V1 or V3 from V1, the square of the ratio of the diameters. And then I can substitute in these values into these. And what that does is it gives me an expression that is down to a single velocity again. Everything, of course, there is a V1 squared and a V1 squared missing in each of these terms. And that gives me an expression that, again, is related to a single velocity, not V1, V2, V3. I would cancel this one out, and I could replace that with an exit coefficient if I wanted to, and add a 1 into the loss factor for that particular velocity if I wanted to. And then I have an expression that is all in terms of the same velocity, which I can solve for the velocity and go through that same iterative process in order to calculate flow rate unknown problems, as we'll see in subsequent examples. So that's the basics of what we need to do in order to add minor losses to our piping systems. The equations change a little bit, but the real thing to understand is that the minor losses come about because of the flow physics through these elements, where we don't have the straight fully developed flow and the same friction losses. We have additional effects that are resulting in greater losses in our piping system compared to a straight section of pipe. And we account for that by going to a reputable source and finding the most appropriate loss coefficient for that particular fitting, and then adding them to our equations in order to account for it. And we'll see examples of this in subsequent videos.